an absolute pleasure, in fact, an honor, to be invited to give this short talk today. I'd like to thank the organizers of the festival for inviting me, particularly Jeremy Melvin, Paul Finch, and Fatoula Fatarous, who've been great hosts and organizers. And of course, it's always wonderful to be back in Amsterdam. So I should say up front that this is going to be a talk, actually quite a short talk in three parts, each of which is preceded by a short video. And I think one of the very tricky challenges about talking outside of your own context is how to present that context to the audience in a way that brings it home. So I've selected three videos that I think help to do exactly that. Each of the films is quite different, but each tries to explain in one way or another what it's like to be living, practicing, and teaching architecture in the world's youngest continent, and also the most architecturally underrepresented continent, Africa. So I live in Johannesburg, one of the world's 50 largest urban conglomerations, and incidentally, the only one not built on a river or close to the sea. I'm also currently the head of the Graduate School of Architecture at the University of Johannesburg, which is Africa's newest and largest postgraduate school. As I've said, we're the world's youngest continent with an average age of around 19.8 compared to Europe's 37.7. So it's a place of enormous energy and aspiration, and in spite of all the headlines, incredible optimism. Although South Africa is certainly not representative of all of Africa, there are parallels and short and shared histories that make it a very interesting test case for what happens north of the borders, especially in relation to the built environment. So the first part of my talk focuses on the recent student protests in South Africa, which have opened up an unexpected space in which to explore some of the complex questions around identity that this festival is also trying to address. The second part looks in greater detail at architectural education itself, focusing, of course, on the graduate school and its students, and the way in which a generation or a new generation of young Africans are attempting to redefine what it means to be African, not just historically, racially, or ethnically, but in terms of what a modern, hybrid, and cosmopolitan African identity looks like in architectural and built environment terms. And lastly, the short video at the end of this takes you back to the title of this talk, What Pliny Said, in a way that I hope will become clear as the talk proceeds. So what did Pliny say, and why is it relevant? His phrase referred to the supposed proliferation of strange hybrid animal species that he claimed could only be found in Africa, citing the leopardus, a cross between a leopard and a lion, as his example. Nowadays, you might say, we read it as shorthand for the continent's imagined capacity for producing uniqueness, bringing forth novelties, things of mystery and wonder, equal parts admiration and despair. There are few places in the world, at least that I know of, where the battles over history and heritage are as problematic as they are in South Africa. Race, class, gender, power, language, religion, ritual, heritage, oppression, freedom, belonging. No stone in South Africa has the hope in hell of being left unturned. This makes for both an incredibly complex society, but also, and I add a caveat here that I'm not South African and therefore see these things slightly differently, an incredibly rich one. Apartheid has played and continues to play a pivotal role in both the country's reckoning with its past and its aspirations for a just, more equitable future. Unlike most other African countries, architectural education in South Africa is an amalgamation of three major influences: Beaux-Arts, Bauhaus, and British. Not just the one inherited by whichever colonial power happened to be in charge, and made to sit rather uneasily with indigenous spatial and built environment practices. The history of South Africa, torn between competing Dutch and British claims to power, resulted in a blended tripartite model of these three traditions, which now struggles to bring forth a fourth narrative on board, that of the African majority, who make up 90% of the population, and whose story, for want of a better word, is barely reflected in the country's pedagogy, architectural or otherwise. Apartheid planning and ideology is so deeply embedded in the South African landscape, in both a real and metaphorical sense, that I am personally not optimistic about its chances of ever being forgotten or forgiven. 24 years ago, Mandela called for reconciliation over retribution, asking 80% of the population to forgive and forget, to build a new rainbow nation without fully interrogating what they had inherited. The Truth and Reconciliation Commission, which held 1,003 public hearings over a five-year period, was absolutely necessary for the country's restorative processes, but it is also widely felt to have been cut short. It failed to address the systematic structural violence and racism of the apartheid regime, or to explore in sufficient depth how those same structures continue to inform the everyday life of the majority of South Africans. Tellingly, too, it exposed a deep rift between the country's youth and their parents. For the older generation, the TRC formed part of a historical process, and the truth that certain compromises had to be made in order to build a democracy on the foundation of reconciliation rather than retribution. But for the younger generation, that process was largely cosmetic. For almost 20 years, those tensions have lain dormant. Both the roads must fall and the fees must fall. Protest movements, which are the subject of the following short video, exemplify the violence and anger stemming from the failure to ask the hard questions, to interrogate the sense of shame, and address the issue of guilt on all sides, not just the two most obvious.
To our own movement, students must fall.
Here on the southern north, we've moved to a bit of a safer place just so that we're able able to speak to the students at least in an environment that has been conducive to bring you this live coverage. But we'll certainly go towards the southern lawns at the moment and bring you all the latest from there in terms of the other reaction and the violent nature of that reaction that is taking place on the other side of the southern lawns. But what I can tell you is that from where I'm standing, I can see again, as you can hear there again, stun grenades being shot again, being fired here on the southern lawns, screams coming from some of the students, and also some of the tires as well and toilets that were burning a bit earlier on. All of that has started again. We'll continue to monitor the situation here on SABC News. We'll bring you the latest throughout the day there, Devon. Certainly, students seem to be quite furious over the latest events that you need to hear.
When I arrived at the then Department of Architecture in 2014, there were 11 students in the master's program, all of whom were white. Today there are 115, of whom 62% are black, and in February 2019, at the start of the new academic year, we will be 123. I'm fully aware that the unit system is old news in the UK and is viewed in some quarters as a London-centric and somewhat outdated educational model. However, in the African context, and I say African since about 15% of our students are from outside South Africa, it has been nothing short of revolutionary.
The Summer Show is the culmination of a two-year process where we get to display some of the best work of all the students and a celebration of that work.
This year's show is a really different look and feel to last year. It's about exuberance, it's about youth, it's about bright colors, bright young things.
I'm most excited about everyone else seeing what we're doing. I think architecture has multiple realms through which you can study it through, and UJ challenges that.
What it means to me is that the year's work, our hard work, being shown to the public and being appreciated by the public and how it's received and how they see it and understand it.
I joined the GSA with a bit of fear because I knew nothing about it. It was the best choice I ever made.
In undergrad, I was very much within my own comfort zone and relying on what I know and what I'm comfortable with, whereas this year has completely pushed that boundary to what I've never thought possible.
Everyone who wants to further their studies in architecture has to do it at the GSA because it's an absolutely fantastic place to be. It is incredibly inspiring, incredibly innovative, completely stretches the individual to your absolute limits. What you thought you couldn't do, what you thought you couldn't achieve, what you thought you couldn't imagine, the GSA helps you to do all of those things.
Tutors enter the school, they find out very quickly that training gives way almost immediately to experimentation. And they quickly find themselves at the leading edge of experimentation, often where they did not expect to be. Which means that they contribute brilliantly, unselfconsciously, and very ambitiously. We are not a school with any answers yet.
We're a school that's interested in formulating questions, good, difficult, thoughtful, ambitious, ethical and complex questions. And we would like to keep it that way, at least for a while.
To explain why the unit system has been so successful, I think, in the African context, I would like to step sideways for a little bit to literature and to the 2003 novel, Elizabeth Costello, by the South African writer J.M. Coetzee. The novel is Elizabeth Costello, as I've said. It was published in 2003. And in one of the chapters, Costello, a white South African and the novel's protagonist, accepts a free cruise on a ship going to Antarctica in exchange for entertaining passengers with a series of lectures. She finds herself paired with another African novelist, a Nigerian, Emmanuel Edugu, whom she had met many years earlier at a pen conference in Kuala Lumpur. Edugu's lecture is about the novel in Africa, but what he has to say seems depressing to her. African culture, he says, is essentially oral and hostile to silent, private reading. The African writer can draw on his or her oral culture to create a different kind of novel from that of the Western literary tradition, but he still will not have an African readership. He is condemned to making his life or his professional life outside of Africa, writing for foreigners. I'm going to quote a very small section of the novel, spoken not by Edugu but by Costello, since it seems to me to go directly to the heart of what African students of architecture, or literature perhaps, are struggling with. The English novel, she says, is written in the first place by English people for English people. That is what makes it the English novel. The Russian novel is written by Russians for Russians. But the African novel is not written by Africans for Africans. African novelists may write about Africa, about African experiences, but they seem to me to be glancing over their shoulder the whole time they write, at the foreigners who will read them. Whether they like it or not, they have accepted the role of interpreter, interpreting Africa to their readers. Yet how can you explore a world in all its depths if at the same time you are having to explain it to outsiders? It is like a scientist trying to give full creative attention to his investigations while at the same time explaining what he is doing to a class of ignorant students. It is too much for one person. It cannot be done, not at the deepest level. That, it seems to me, is the root of your problem, having to perform your Africanness at the same time you write it. In the context of African schools of architecture, exactly like Costello states, both staff and students must necessarily act simultaneously as interpreters and investigators, explaining a world that is often invisible to Western-trained eyes, both to themselves and others, yet at the same time exploring it in all its depth. It's a difficult and complex task. But design, with its emphasis on intuition, fluidity, self-reflexivity, and an expanded and expanding view of process-led investigations, seems to offer African students the much-needed space to explore prior to explanation, not during it. And I'm coming to the last part of the talk now, and there's another very short video. And it's about belonging and alienation. So alienation is often described as the condition of rejecting and or being rejected. And there are many ways in which it is both constructed and experienced. The black architect lives in a society that has rejected his or her culture for hundreds of years. The white architect belongs to the historically European culture that rejected African culture and is now rejected by it in turn. Today, he or she is the non-European, I'm talking about South Africa, whose society refused to acknowledge and take root with an indigenous culture, producing something new. The white architect is the non-black whom blacks see as apart from indigenous culture. Both do not know yet whether this is a dead end or can be made a new beginning. Thank you.
Zintinya batom down. That's a summer as a small team.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, Lesley. There's an awful lot there which we can talk about. But I thought one thing I would just like to look a bit more at is the idea that design as a sort of process, as a sort of a combination, a synthetic process of all sorts of different influences, is actually quite a suitable vehicle for people from an African background, imbued with an African culture, to develop their own intellectual position. Whereas as a protagonist, the second protagonist in the Curator novel, basically comes to a dead end.
Yeah.
Basically, it's a bit like, it's not the only novel that does that. I mean, Thomas Mann's Dr. Faustus is about the impossibility of writing a novel, basically. But I think that the idea of design, and is it because, perhaps it's a very simplistic question, because design is optimistic and novels are not necessarily so?
I think it's a combination. I mean, we're essentially, and I say we with a caveat, a very... our history is very much rooted in the body, whether it's oral cultures, it's art practices, it's the idea of the body as the vehicle for all forms of cultural expression. Now, design comes from the body. It comes from a strange place of intuition, if you like. Mm. And what I've noticed with the majority of our students is the freedom to use the body, to use one's kind of corporeal material as the site of investigation has been incredibly liberating. So I think historically architecture was taught very much as a kind of engineering science driven quasi-rational form of expression. And in this context we're asking students to place themselves at the center of investigations, and design seems to open up a language in them which is not dependent on the understanding of canon, it's not dependent on articulation, it comes from a different source. So it's been incredibly liberating in a way that I didn't expect. Yeah.
And you can and lived experience, whatever that lived experience is, can be the raw material for design.
Absolutely, and I mean, I think, particularly in South Africa, the notion that architecture is a universal kind of set of abstract principles holds almost no water, because you have populations who are experiencing the built environment simultaneously in many different ways. So to have broken free of the kind of dogma of canon has made it's made a new beginning possible.
Sure. Yeah. And of course, some of the people living in townships or very poor communities are incredibly inventive.
Absolutely.
In constructional terms.
Yep.
And I think this is another point I'd like to sort of pursue a little. Is about the visual experience, the visual culture that these people create through even the most basic
acts.
You know, the brutalist artists or the artists who were interested in brutalism in the 50s in Europe would have died, I think, for some of the constructions that these people can make. They're inventive, they're practical, they're obviously extremely cheap by definition. Yet they combine in a sort of a very difficult beauty, because it's difficult because it's obviously so deprived.
Yeah, there was a clip that I showed. I don't know that many people would have seen it, but of one of our students, black South African student, who is constructing a dictionary of terms in Zulu that have no equivalent in English, but they are building terms. And I found out, for example, that there are words for the way color appears in sunlight that have no equivalent in any other language. Yeah. But I think architecture has been very, very slow to pick up on these as being of any value. Mm-hmm. So I think we're still in, as we said in the video, in a very experimental stage. But I think what's been very interesting about the student protests over the past 2 or 3 years is that a space has opened up, both politically and, yeah. I guess, culturally, in which these things can be debated, tested, performed, and very, very slowly begin to develop our own canon.
I think that's really interesting that in Zulu, and this may well be in other languages yeah. across Africa, that there's a whole rich oral culture which is architectural discourse.
Absolutely.
But it wouldn't really take place at the Architectural Association or Harvard Graduate School of Design, and it probably should.
Absolutely, yeah.
So, other things, this space that opens up, obviously it wasn't purely about roads must fall and fees must fall, but in your view, is that something that has made it possible over the last 2 or 3 years to talk in a different way?
Yeah, and I think South Africa itself has a long tradition, a long history of student activism, forcing change. Yeah. So in a sense, this was nothing new. But what's been very interesting was that it was targeted specifically at tertiary education. Mm. So for once, universities couldn't duck. And the issues around kind of transformation and decolonization, I think, are very specific to the South African context. Mm. But actually, because nobody really knows what they mean, again, there's a space that's opened up for us to test what those things mean.
Yeah.
And, universities at their heart really are in the business of producing new knowledge. If we don't do that, we might as well pack up and go home. Mm. So this has been a really fortuitous bringing together, I think, of the political demands, but also the anger. And it's one of the things that we keep saying to the students at the moment, that to be angry is really only the first step. You need that as a catalyst, but that anger has to be disciplined, it has to be refined, it has to be tested, it has to be remade. Mm. And I think that's what certainly the school is in the business of doing.
Yeah. Now, I think that's the fascinating point, because it's the as you say, there's a long tradition of student activism, but that is what has driven certain sorts of, against apartheid, certain sorts of concession, possibly, or an even more brutal crackdown, and it's still happening now. And I think you're right to identify that 20 years after the Truth and Reconciliation, 25 years after Mandela became president, there were still big problems. A lot was swept under the carpet. Yeah. And the issue of fees, I think, is a litmus paper. It's not obviously the only thing.
No, absolutely. And I think this is very common to all post-colonial societies. Education is seen really as a tool of liberation. It's a bit like you can't really talk about democracy in Africa in the same way that you talk about it somewhere else. Democracy is an expression of freedom. It's an expression of independence. So it's not just about making a political choice. And I think fees and the question of access to university was such a huge test of the post-apartheid government, because it was part of the way in which people moved class mobility.
Yeah.
So in some senses, in that context, it's not just about knowledge. It's not just about the kind of freedom of expression. It's also about the freedom of social mobility, which is what most independent movements come to power on. So it's been a real nexus for very competing claims about the meaning of education. And that's, for an educator, is a really interesting space to be.
Yeah. And the staff that you have presumably reflect the composition of the student body?
Yes and no. I should say I'm the only full-time staff member. That is about to change.
Yeah.
But we have a group of about 23 part-time staff. But because we are such a young continent in general, the staff are all under the age of 30, most of them. So that, on the one hand, has this incredible kind of exuberance and enthusiasm and ambition, but also not a huge amount of experience. Mm. So it's been a very interesting role to be both kind of leader and mentor kind of simultaneously, which is not always the way you lead. Mm. So I think, I've grown a huge amount in the 4 years, but I think the staff have equally grown. And it's incredible to see, young students who've just graduated. You give them the responsibility and the opportunity, and 9.5 times out of 10, they rise to the challenge.
Yeah. One of the things you mentioned is the sort of formal, as it were, apparatus of the profession, the architecture profession in South Africa, draws on these three sources: Beaux-Arts, Bauhaus, and British. Mm. Now, the Beaux-Arts and British are obvious; they're coming through the colonial routes. Mm. The Bauhaus there came by a slightly different route, didn't it?
Yeah, and I mean, slightly through the Dutch tradition, but also there was a huge, you know, whole generation of South African architects who went overseas to work with, you know, some of the modernist greats. And I find that a very interesting conundrum, because if you think about it, you know, modernism in Europe, particularly in the sort of 40s, 50s, 60s, was always aligned with the avant-garde, with a kind of left-leaning agenda. And I think it must have been very, very difficult for these architects to have come to Europe and to the United States and then to return to practice the same profession, but in a completely different political context. And I often talk about there being a kind of schizophrenia, or almost at the heart of the profession in South Africa, which is to do with these competing ways in which the profession has been used. So I think of, you know, many, many disciplines, architecture and kind of apartheid ideology are so tightly interlinked that actually separating them is its own academic project.
I think that's absolutely true. I mean, I'm thinking of, you know, back to a conversation we had yesterday on the festival hall stage about brutalism, and you know, the point was made that brutalism, as you say, was sort of aligned with a sort of welfare statist agenda very largely. Well, in South Africa, it was the apartheid state that built brutalist buildings, or what we might think of, you know, the Johannesburg City Hall or something like
Absolutely,
that.
Absolutely, yeah.
And so, what in the UK was meant to be this sort of freedom within limits for a generation that were experimenting with freedom of you know, people who were then young in the 1940s, 50s, 60s, was actually being used as an active instrument of the repressive state.
Yeah. I mean, we were talking about it yesterday at dinner, that I think there's a tendency to think that architecture is a universal language, that, you know, the same terms apply everywhere. But actually, and particularly around cities, these are deeply cultural responses to the built environment. And I think one of the challenges in Africa is in fact in the translation of indigenous belief systems around things like space, form, weather, temperature, culture, you name it. How do those things, how are they translated into a response to the city? So we talk about a city as if it was the same everywhere, and actually phenomenally not.
Yeah. I mean, as you say, Johannesburg is one of the 50 biggest cities in the world, but the only one that doesn't have a water supply.
Yeah.
You know, and it's there obviously because it was sitting on what was then the world's largest lump of gold. And that, the economic value of that, made it possible to build a city in a place where you really shouldn't have a city.
Yeah, but part of its culture as a result is, it's, you know, people talk about Lagos being the ultimate hustle city. For me, Johannesburg is. It's a city of incredible energy. It's a bit of a cliche, but also incredible inventiveness. You know, people just make the Afrikaans word, which I'm not going to say, but you know, make a plan. People just make a plan.
In
architectural terms, I find that really interesting because it's the opposite of what architecture does.
Exactly, and I think this is, you know, it's unlocking that creativity and actually trying to make some sort of common purpose for your students and for the wider profession and possibly for other people, which I think is a really fascinating thing. It really is architecture as liberation, and in a way that you know, the apparatus of depression, the term I've used just now, whether it's here in Europe or in Africa, is often just seen as keeping a status quo, a mechanism to keep the status quo. Whereas what you're finding through your educational process is the opposite.
Yeah. And I mean, I think the conversation for so long around the relationship between Africa and architecture has always been that Africa in some way is lacking. It's not wealthy enough, it's not ambitious enough, it's somehow second class to the discipline. But actually I think the reverse is true. Actually, architecture as a discipline, the way we currently understand it, is not up to the task of Africa. And that's a very exciting space to be in.
Yes. And then it may not be called architecture anymore.
Absolutely.
It might be called something else. And it might be a Zulu word that will become, another...
I mean, it's quite interesting. One of the very first talks I gave was at the Prince of Wales Institute in London. It was just when I'd finished studying at the Bartlett. And I was very nervous. It was organized by the Society of Black Architects, and I got up and I gave, you know, this whole talk about race and identity in architecture. And halfway through the talk, someone came into the room and switched the lights on. And I mean, I was nervous enough as it was, but I mean, I literally had a heart attack. And this man was standing there, a black British guy, and said to me, "Young lady, you know, I'd like to ask you a question." So, you know, headlights are on me, and what's the question? He says, "Do you know the meaning or the origins of the word opera?" I'm like, "No, I've got no idea." And he said, "Well," and he was a musicologist. He was actually the first black person to graduate with a PhD in musicology from Oxford. And he said, "Look, opera, as we understand it, is the remnants of something that was recreated when the records of what the original art form were lost. So it was a kind of it was almost like a fiction. So what we call opera today actually has very little relationship to its original art form. So he says, the question I have for you is, if you bring these two terms, race and architecture, together, are you prepared for the possibility that what you get in the end is not exactly architecture, and it's not exactly race either? Mm. And for me, this question was asked 25 years ago. I think it still holds true.
Well, it's also that in one sense, architecture is an institution and race is an institution.
Yeah.
It's a
they're constructed, yes.
Exactly. And, yeah. And what we need to do, I mean, we now know that the 19th century era constructions of race were absolute fiction, absolute nonsense. Yeah. And yet they still persist in certain sorts of policy.
The history of the world is predicated on this supposed difference, which actually at a biological level isn't even enough to make the difference between two species of cat.
Yeah, so. Yeah. So yeah, that's why I say it's complete nonsense, but it was a convenient fiction which, among other things, justified, you know, takeover of much of the world by a small part of it.
Yeah.
And I think it's interesting, I mean, coming back to the way South Africa, its particular experience, suffered from this. I read a very interesting book a year or two ago by Herbert Guillemy, who's an Afrikaner historian, and he lays bare the absolute horror of the early settlement around Cape Town in the 17th century, and how the way it was run by its local governors, but also from the Dutch East India Company in this city, made both racial tension and slavery inevitable.
Absolutely. Yeah.
You know, and you know, so for 360 years, you know, you've been both, South Africa has both intensified that process, but also fought against it.
Yeah. I mean, there's two things I want to say in response to that. I mean, one goes back again to a South African writer, one of my favorite writers, Gordimer, who says, you know, if you were to ask a white South African, like in their 40s or 50s, what is apartheid? They would tell you that it was a, you know, governmental construct, it was a set of laws, it was a kind of historical event. If you asked a black person what apartheid was, they would say, well, it's, you know, the daily wait to a train, it's low wages, it's lack of housing. In other words, it's the lived experience of it. So the kind of abstract construct and lived experience are two separate things. But what I find really interesting about South Africa is that it is the most cosmopolitan, the most diverse, and the most multicultural country in Africa. It has an opportunity, I think, to reconstruct what it means to be African. And it's very interesting to me that the younger generation are just beginning to understand this. Yes, it is about black and white, it is about the history, but it's also about a forward-thinking identity, which for me is incredibly optimistic, not just for South Africa, but actually for the rest of the continent.
Which comes back to the point about design being about optimism,
absolutely,
where writing, whether it's novels, poetry or anything else, even journalism, is not necessarily optimistic, whereas I think it's impossible to conceive of design without, you know, unless you're Massimo Cucciari or someone like that.
Yeah, no, but it's got a kind of a built-in, it is about an attempt to make the world a better place.
Good. Well, Lesley, that's been a fascinating talk. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
And I think we've all been challenged to think about what is new and what is good that is coming out of Africa, and how can we use platforms like the World Architecture Festival, but we can't do it on our own, to bring that onto a world stage.
Yeah.
Thank you.
For the opportunity. Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you.